Aloha, welcome to another episode of ThinkTech Hawaii's Movers, Shakers, and Reformers Politics in Hawaii series. I'm your host, Carl Campagna. Today, we are going to talk a bit about immigration. We're going to learn about some of the things that have been going on in the last, week or so, related to immigration. We have Ms. Clare Hanusz. I knew I was going to get that
wrong.
A
tough one.
We have Clare Hanusz, attorney, joining us today. She's an immigration attorney working on federal cases, and we are going to learn as much as we can about the most recent Muslim ban put in place through the executive order from our current Republican administration. We're going to learn a bit about that. We're going to talk about some of those parameters, and we're going to learn a bit about what's going on here in Hawaii from an immigration perspective and some of our concerns that we may have. So welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's nice to be here.
Excellent. So you've been here before. You've been on before.
I have.
Excellent.
A couple times.
So you know what to do and how
to do
it.
An old pro.
Yeah. Excellent. So no, I do appreciate it. Okay, so first of all, tell us a bit about you, where you work, and what you work on and why.
Sure. I'm an attorney. I practice exclusively immigration nationality law. I actually went into law school because I was interested in immigration law, and I've been practicing for the better part of close to 20 years. And I've practiced both in the nonprofit sector on my own as a solo practitioner, and now I'm with Damon, Leong, Kupchak, Hastert, a law firm here downtown.
That's a lot of words. Say that again.
Damon, Leong, Kupchak, Hastert.
Excellent. Excellent. So if anybody has any immigration questions, that's where you want to go.
Thanks for that.
Okay. All right. So let's jump into. We know that we actually saw each other recently,
okay.
But we know there was a protest demonstration at the airport here in Honolulu this last Saturday. Saturday or Sunday? Either way,
Sunday.
And Sunday. Yeah. And that's an important thing. Some people say there was 100. Some people say up to 300 people who showed up, but it wasn't only in Honolulu. It existed
right.
Really nationwide.
Right.
At multiple airports, people showing up in opposition
yeah,
to
probably
this.
Probably 30 to 40 airports, at least 30 nationwide. Right.
Which is so relevant. We
yeah.
really need to
yeah.
recognize that people are starting are really standing up.
Yeah.
And this, you know, from the Women's March to a number of different
right.
groups.
Right.
People are standing up saying, we don't agree with this.
Right.
And that's a relevant piece, and we need to know that that matters.
Right.
And find more ways to make that matter as well. But so that's all based on this Muslim ban executive order put in place by our current Republican administration that no one seems to understand. No one seems to understand why. So one question is, first of all, let's start at the table. The president doing an executive order about anything, but in this case, a Muslim ban for entry into the United States, is it legal?
Executive orders are legal. There's nothing that expressly discusses them in the Constitution, but presidents have been doing this for centuries.
So from the very first president, George Washington.
I don't know if it was George Washington, but somebody shortly after him started. And in Obama, every president issues executive orders.
Yes.
And it's one way for them to kind of come out after the election with, making good on some of the promises
so
they made during the campaign.
What is the force of them? I mean, in this instance, his executive order was an immediate.
Well, right. So Congress makes the laws. Right, so they can't create new law, but there is, you know, within the Constitution and within the executive powers, certain things that the president is allowed to do or is allowed to try to do. One of President Obama's executive orders was to close Guantanamo. That didn't happen in 8 years, but it was symbolic, and he made it, and I guess he tried. One of his other executive orders concerning immigration was to provide additional protections for what are called the Dreamers, people who came to the United States as children, no fault of their own, and have lived here, to give them a temporary protection from deportation and the ability to work. And then he tried to expand that to include parents of children who were U.S. citizens or permanent residents. And then that failed in the court. So once a president issues an executive order, a number of things can happen. One is it can just sail by. And some of the less controversial ones do. And there have been many executive orders that we've never heard about and probably didn't have much impact in our lives. But some of them are biggies, okay? And the ones that President Trump has been rolling out have been kind of biggies. And And they can either get rescinded by the president or they can be challenged by Congress if they're overstepping on congressional power, or most likely they're challenged in the courts. And so President Trump on Friday night issued this executive order. This is the third executive order he's issued regarding immigration. And they've all been, as someone who's an immigration attorney and advocate, they've been pretty bad, but this one just kind of took the cake as far as what it was prohibiting.
And what were the other two?
So, well, one was the build the wall, right?
Okay.
Okay. I, you know, it's funny, like that was huge news, and then a day, that was 2 days before. And then this one, and then with the environmental challenges that are coming up, one quickly gets overshadowed by the next.
Some people refer to that as a shock event.
Mm-hmm.
Let me do a thing that's going to get everybody up in arms, and then they won't really be paying attention to other things.
Right, right, right. Well, the thing is, we're all paying attention,
which is good.
Right, we're all paying attention, but and it's really, I mean, following these and the rapid succession of these executive orders and what they mean, and the implications is kind of a full-time job.
Yeah.
Which most of us.
Don't have time.
And again, this is only, we're only talking about focus on immigration. I'm not sure what's going on in other areas that I'm also very, very concerned about.
Right.
And the other executive order had to do with enforcement priorities, and it actually kind of criminalizes some parts of the Immigration Act that or actions by immigrants that were not criminal before, that were civil offenses, and so we're concerned about more and more people being caught up who have no criminal records but being caught up in you know the immigration
as
net.
A result of being an immigrant.
Right.
You're an immigrant,
right.
So you're suspect.
Being an immigrant, and you know specifically these target undocumented immigrants, which fall into kind of two groups generally: people who've come on valid visas and have overstayed, and there's lots of them, and they're not all Mexican. A lot of them are Korean and Japanese and Irish and from all over the world. And then there's the unauthorized immigrants or people who had unlawful entries into the United States. And combining those groups, there's about 11 million, right? So it's a huge number.
It's a huge number.
And
there's a lot of talk, though, people back and forth on the issues. On one side, there's the compassionate view, and there's the American principles. We want to allow people in and make sure that we're providing better opportunities for a lot of people, and that's what some of that is about.
Mm-hmm.
But then the other side of that is, great, spectacular, do it legally.
Yeah, well, the problem for a lot of people is there is no path. There is no legal path to reside in the United States, work, and be with families. So we have a lot of families separated. We have a really unique situation in the United States where we have this, you know, 2,000-mile border to the south, and it's really kind of think of it in simple terms, you know, the largest first world, third world border in the world, and that's going to obviously present lots and lots of challenges. And then we have the U.S.-Canada border, which presents a lot fewer challenges.
Because it's not first world, third world.
Because it's not a first world, third world, and people generally in Canada are very happy to stay in Canada. So just because of that and that history, and the history also of a lot of the United States, what is the United States now? Was Mexico, right?
A lot of
not,
it was.
Not that long ago. And so these historical and these family ties, and then the economic world order that, you know, a lot of us in the United States benefit by being able to buy cheap things. Well, the people who make those cheap things get paid peanuts, often not enough to feed their families, and so they're searching for a better future for their families.
So when you say that there's no legal path in for them, why is it? Because they don't have the money for that legal path?
No, because you know generally to get a legal status in the United States, to get that green card, right? You get it one of two ways. It's either through a family member, a qualified family member who petitions for you, and mm-hmm. It can't be a cousin, it can't be an auntie, it has to be a spouse, a parent, an adult child. So this whole thing of anchor babies is really silly because a kid has to be 21 before the kid can file a petition for the parent anyway, or a brother and sister. Okay, and depending on the relationship, there's either a short wait or a long wait, but you have to have that initial relationship. The other way in is through an employment-based visa or employment-based green cards, which are really, really super hard to get. You have to, right? And for reason, you know, protecting American jobs.
Visa versus green card.
You have to the visa's the first step, and then the green card follows.
Okay, green card means what?
Green card. No, that's good. So, a green card. If you're a green card holder, that means that you're a lawful permanent resident.
Okay. Okay. Whether you can, are you a dual resident potentially?
Well, so you're still a citizen of the country that you were born in, or the country that you're a national of, right? So say you were born in Canada, you came to the United States as a student, met your wife, she was a U.S. citizen, she filed papers for you, and nothing's automatic, right? Everything is kind of step by step, and then you became a lawful permanent resident. You got your green card, which allows you to live and work in the United States. Indefinitely.
Right. Okay.
And then after you have a green card for either generally 3 years or 5 years, you can apply for naturalization, i.e. citizenship.
Got it.
Okay, so there's nothing's automatic. There are all these steps, and you have to have a pathway in.
Okay.
Okay, and
so for the pathway begins with I have a job or I have family, so I need to apply for some visa to get me there.
Right.
Once I get there, maybe there's a scenario that allows me to get a green card.
There's non-immigrant visas and there's immigrant visas. The immigrant visa is kind of an automatic green card. The non-immigrant visas, some of those you can convert.
Okay.
But it's just kind of long story short. It's tough to get in the door, right?
Yeah.
And then you have a lot of people who kind of came in the door and they weren't supposed to come in the door, or they came in the door as a tourist and they never went home,
right.
And they fell in love and they got married and they had children and they're
and
doing everything
that
right.
Sometimes that's their plan.
You know.
For some people,
probably yes. For some people, no.
Yeah, okay. You never want to paint one brush on everybody.
No, and that's the thing. It is very, very individualized, and that's the problem it's easy for people to make sweeping generalizations, right?
In any broad sweeping policy.
All immigrants are wonderful. It's not true. Not all native-born people are wonderful.
No.
All immigrants are bad. Not true either.
Not true. Right.
So
which agency? Let's go to the next step. Okay, so there's this process, and it isn't easy. And it isn't available to everyone, but they still need, they're sort of looking for a better opportunity, a better life, so that's where we end up with illegal immigration.
Right.
How to handle that? Well, which agency or agencies handle that?
So the federal agency is the Department of Homeland Security, right, which was set up, it was a new agency that was set up after the September 11, 2001 bombings. Okay, so what was INS, Immigration and Nationalization Service, was brought under this large new umbrella agency called the Department of Homeland Security. And so that's made up of Customs and Border Protection. Okay, those are the folks at the airport and at the borders, at the what are called ports of entry, right? So any airport, any international airport is going to be a port of entry. Okay. It's also made up of United States Citizenship and Immigration Services. Our local USCIS office is down at what was Restaurant Row. I don't know what it's called now, but at Punch Bowl in Ala Moana.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
So that's Citizenship
and Immigration. People still refer to it as
Restaurant Row, and probably always will. Like Holiday Mart is Don Quixote. Also, Immigration and Customs Enforcement. The ICE. ICE is as it says, enforcement. And that's also located in Ala Moana, kind of across from Restaurant Row in the old, beautiful, historic building that's set back a little bit that people see when they're racing up and down Ala Moana.
All right, so where does the Department of State come in this? Anywhere?
Oh, so the Department of State comes in overseas. Only the Department of State can issue visas overseas.
Okay.
So they have a very, very special role in this. Okay, and so the whole issue, kind of jumping back to Friday night and this executive order, basically, you know, the executive order did kind of three major things. One is that it barred all people from Syria indefinitely from entering the United States.
All people indefinitely.
All Syrians indefinitely.
All right. We're gonna hold on that for a moment.
Okay.
Barring all people from Syria indefinitely is okay. So, all right, we're gonna take a quick break. This was really, really quick anyway. A quick break, we'll be back in 1 minute. Thank you.
Aloha, my name is John Waihe, and I used to be a part of all the things that you might be angry at. I served in government here and may have made decisions that affects you. So I want to invite you in. I want to invite you in to Talk Story with me and some very special guests every other Monday here at Talk Story with John Waihe. Come on in, join us, express your opinion, learn more about your state, and then do something about it. Aloha.
This is John Adenuya from ThinkTech Hawaii, Keys to Success. We'd like to thank all of our viewers for tuning in and enjoying the show as we enjoy giving it to you.
We are very grateful for all the wonderful feedback we receive from our viewers. My name is Danelia, D-A-N-E-L-I-A.
And I'm the other half of the duo, John Newman. We thank you all. Aloha.
Aloha.
Welcome back to ThinkTech Hawaii's Movers, Shakers, and Reformers, Politics in Hawaii series. This, again, we're talking about immigration. We're talking about, yes, the most recent ban from last Friday. We're talking about all of the aspects, and we're trying to learn what we can about what is going on and how it impacts everyone, where it can impact everyone. And what we just learned before the break was that the entirety of the country of Syria has now been banned from entering the United States. So let's jump back to one of my previous questions. It's temporary, though, right?
No, Syrians are not temporary.
Syrians are not temporary.
Syrians are not temporary. Syrians are indefinite. The other two groups have time.
Does everyone know that Steve Jobs was Syrian? Or from Syrian, anyway.
I did not know that.
Yeah, Steve Jobs was from, if what I've read is correct, Steve Jobs was from Syrian immigrants. Anyway.
There are a lot of Syrians who've contributed greatly to our country, I'm sure.
And that's the greatest point. Everyone in the United States of America, other than Native Americans, are immigrants who have brought a great deal to this country. We need to remember that. We are all immigrants except for the Native Americans. So.
Right.
Okay, all right, so what we were just talking about again was, yes, all of the Syrians, so it's not...
Indefinitely barred. Right. Then refugees.
Unless there's a change or another executive order saying, okay,
oh, right, right. Well, I mean, so there's an... Let's go through the groups and then we'll talk about the challenges to it.
Okay.
Okay, that might be easier. So all Syrians indefinitely. And then nationals or citizens of, and I wrote it down, the seven countries, right? Iran, Iraq, Syria, Sudan, Somalia, Libya, and Yemen. Barred for entry for basically 90 days, at least 90 days, but there was a 90-day period put in. Barred from, so if you were from Somalia and you had been issued a visa, if you were, say you were a child and your mother lived in Somalia and she had filed an immigrant petition for you, you went through all of the processing, right, which takes at least a year and a fair amount of money as well. You finally have that visa issued, you think you're gold, you're set to fly to the United States and meet your mom. And then you're stopped at the airport and you're told that the visa's been revoked. And that's what they did. They automatically revoked all of the visas that had been issued.
In one fell swoop. So this was, this did not require the legislature, the Congress. This did not require, this was because the president said this and because he has that authority.
Over the Department of State, right.
Whereas we could say in an executive order, we're going to close Guantanamo Bay, and it doesn't happen. This one is, we're going to ban people from these locations, and it happened immediately.
Right, right. So that's why people were scrambling the next day. The other big group of people that was affected, and this was really shocking to me, was all refugees who were scheduled to be resettled in the United States, barred them from entry for 120 days. Didn't matter where they were from. Burma.
Wow.
Right, I mean, some of the places with pretty bad human rights records who had been again, and to get to the point where you've been declared by the United Nations High Commission for Refugees a refugee, and you've been screened. I mean, the screening process is extensive. It takes 18 months to 2 years to get to the point where you're issued a visa, and most people are not. So it's a very, very select, chosen few. And the international NGOs work with nonprofit organizations in the United States who prepare places for them to live, communities to welcome them.
By the way, NGO is non-governmental
organization. Right, right. And so all these people who had been in the pipeline, who had been, victims of torture, victims of war, some of them had already have family who were here, who were trying to reunite. Their lives were completely put on hold.
Yeah.
I heard a story of an Iranian, a gay Iranian man who had been granted refugee status. He had been in Turkey, awaiting his. He already had his visa. He was in the process of getting his ticket to come. He's now completely. currently in limbo. And these are people who've sold everything. They thought the next step was clear for them finally. And their lives have been put on hold.
It's an example of not understanding or not caring, perhaps, of what the ramifications might
be. Right. So the ramifications went far and wide. There is one local organization that works on refugee resettlement. They have two families that have been held up.
Here in Hawaii.
I also heard a story of an Iranian student whose spouse was supposed to come to the United States and was denied entry to the, so, you know, you get to the airport, you're in line to check in, and then they look at your passport at the ticket counter, and they say, "Oh no, sorry, your visa's actually been revoked."
Wow. And then you're detained and/or sent back.
Well, these are people who never even made it. So there were a few groups of people, right? There were the people who were in process of coming to the United States, mm-hmm. right? So some of them were stopped at the airport and sent back. A group of people who were already in transit overnight, including, and this was the big case that prompted the lawsuit on Saturday, an Iraqi who had been a translator for the U.S. military, right, whose life was in grave danger in Iraq for what he had done for the United States.
Right.
He made it here, but then he was detained. Now, they were able eventually to get him out. Right. But there were, we don't know how many people, we're still trying to calculate, who made it here and then who were sent back,
right,
and who are now stuck indefinitely abroad. Students from these seven countries who had been abroad for holiday or for, family member for research, they can't get back into the United States.
But, again, ramifications. You have to hope that they just weren't aware of it and hope that it wasn't that they didn't care. Because if they weren't aware of it, that's bad enough. But not caring, I think, is worse.
I mean, to not have thought through this is such incredibly gross negligence.
And it was, as has been suggested, it was just to fulfill a campaign promise.
Right, right.
It didn't matter who it impacted or how.
Right, and the agencies are saying that it wasn't fully vetted through them.
Right.
What would normally happen is you'd kind of go through with the agencies all the different scenarios, and then you would tweak the policy to not have some of these bad results.
Yeah.
That was not done.
Well, one of the things that happened was the acting AG, the acting attorney general, just fired.
Right. Because of this.
Let me ask this question. First of all, what role does the attorney general have, or the attorneys general have, in this case?
Okay. So there are multiple, I don't know how many lawsuits, but there are multiple lawsuits filed nationwide over, challenging various provisions in this executive order. And they're challenging specific provisions. So it was interesting, the ACLU attorney who Anthony Romero, who argued the case in New York on Saturday, said that it was very clear that the attorneys for the Department of Justice really had no clue about what to say, how to answer the judge's questions. They were completely taken aback. The attorney general,
Sally Yates,
who was sacked on Saturday. I mean, the role of the attorney general is to help decide what's lawful, what's not lawful, and then what position the government attorney should take as far as
defending. And her position was don't defend.
Her position was that she thought that this was an unlawful executive order. So she directed the attorneys, hundreds of however many thousands of attorneys underneath her, not to defend this unlawful act. Well, that was too much for President Trump.
And promptly our Republican administration fired her immediately.
Yeah, and called her a traitor. She had been a federal prosecutor for like 30 years. I mean,
if you don't agree with me, you're a traitor.
Right. And apparently she knew. I had heard stories that she knew by opposing this.
That would happen.
Yeah. And she was ready to take the fall. So good for her. I mean, it takes courageous people right now who are willing to...
It's a statement. It's taking a position. It's letting people know. And it helps to continue this conversation,
right,
so that we can hopefully get to a better place eventually.
And so talking about the roles of attorney general, right, our state attorney general came out along with 16 or 17 other state attorney generals immediately opposing this.
Right.
Now, it's symbolic. Okay, I mean, the Attorney General isn't going to be directing attorneys to, you know, this is not going to be challenged in state court. It's all going to be challenged in federal court. Right. But what a great message. What a great message. Absolutely. That Hawaii was out there in the front, Governor Ige was out there in
the front.
The
people who are supposed to be helping to ensure our laws are being followed and that are enforcing those laws are saying, at least on the legal side, are saying, we don't agree with this.
Right.
And that's the statement that's right. being made, and that's right. where it needs to be better understood. Right. So, okay, another thing that happened is, and this goes into the final thing that we'll do here, is when the federal judge, what was her name?
Donnelly.
When the federal judge came out and said and made her statement or her ruling about it, which was what exactly? Her ruling was to say that this was not legal or it should not be followed.
That the plaintiffs had a significant chance of winning the merits of their case, and so she enjoined or issued a stay of the executive order.
Okay, so that comes from the federal court.
Right.
And as a result or subsequent to that, the administration said, yeah, we don't care. Or what did they, their response was to say, thank you, but we're going forward anyway.
Their response was a little tricky. It said that we will respect the decision of the court. They continue to believe that this is a lawful order. It does not open. I've not read anything that has said that the government was going to defy the order. But what's problematic is that there's been inconsistent application of the stay. And so you still have, I mean, I'm part of all these attorney listservs where, you know, volunteer attorneys have been showing up at airports from the beginning. And they're saying that, there are still people that are being turned back. There are still people who are being held. And they shouldn't be at this point. They did clarify that green card holders, it was in the national interest.
Is that happening at the state level? State level people are doing this, or it's still a federal?
No, these are all federal. These are all federal federal employees.
What this brings up, and unfortunately, this is like the last thing, and then we have to shut the show down, unfortunately. But this brings up the constitutional crisis issue,
right.
Where then that conversation, and unfortunately, we don't have time to go into this conversation. But that is basically freedom of religion is what some people
right.
are saying
right.
is a constitutional issue,
right.
with regards to this executive order, and then the other side of that is the potential denying or the potential of going against and denying what the federal ruling was. And those are the two areas where
right.
where
discrimination based on religion and national origin, and then this right where you've set up this battle between the administration and this battleground between the administration and the courts.
Right.
I'm not a constitutional law expert, but my reading of this is clearly unconstitutional because it's so specific in its targeting of protected groups.
And that's what people are looking at. That's where the ACLU is out there. That's where there's a number of groups that are trying to.
Right, and there's a local group that's formed, the Hawaii Coalition for Civil Rights. There's a press conference going on right now. There's
right now.
22, 23 groups that have banded
so,
together.
Okay, if we have any time left here, thank you so much. We appreciate it. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, Claire.
Thank you.
Thank you to ThinkTech staff and crew. We will see you next week. Take care.